So I want to talk just a little bit about my background, and then roughly this coincides with the 13 years that I taught at Columbia University and a particular intellectual environment that was unfolding in those years, which led to this article on field conditions. This roughly coincides with the period when I was a dean at Princeton, and then the third section covers from 2012 to the present. Now, Emilio has said 2 hours, which is sort of dangerous. You give me 2 hours and I will talk for 2 hours. If we're lucky, the computer will run out of power before that. There's a lot of material here, and it's in a way a little bit indulgent to be able to tell you my life story this way. But I'll try and move through this quickly, and I hope things are of some interest. In 1978, I came down to New York to study at the Institute for Architecture and Urban Studies, which was started in 67 by Peter Eisenman, and it occupied this penthouse looking over Bryant Park and the New York Public Library. So in a way, my first exposure to architecture was in this kind of extraordinary atmosphere of a small think tank in New York City where the historians and theorists from Europe, Manfredo Caffori would come, but also the practicing architects of New York City. So you see here Peter Eisenman, of course, Mario Gandolsonis, Diana Agres, Tony Fidler, Kenneth Frampton. So it was really, you know, I had a very disorganized architectural education, but I was lucky to have a very good teacher. And the other thing about the Institute is it was a very lively center with exhibitions and so on. This is an exhibition that coincided with the Beaux-Arts Drawings exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art. That's a page from Robert Venturi's thesis. That's a young Graham Coalhouse there with the hair. So all of these people were coming through the Institute. Was really, again, I had an extraordinary luck to land there in New York in 1978. And already there, I think built into the logic of the Institute was this idea that architecture was a kind of cultural practice, and as much as the production of buildings and teaching students about design was things like the lecture series, like the journal oppositions, which really served to kind of elevate the level of theoretical discussion in the United States. So discussions around typology, again, authors, I mean, you can't read it, but that's all, Rafael Moneo on Aldo Rossi, Denise Scott Brown, and Tony Vidler. You know, you see the cast of characters there. So. And this was the moment, I think, also when architecture was engaging with theoretical reflection in a way that was very much embedded in the discipline. So questions of typology, questions about the relationship of architecture to the city were very much on the table. Then there were two, at that time, sort of young guys at the Institute, Bernard Schumi and Rem Koolhaas, and both of whom were finishing up projects that were dedicated to sort of thinking about and understanding New York City as a laboratory for thinking about urbanism in a new way. So Schumi's Manhattan Transcripts and Koolhaas's Delirious New York. Also, I think very significant at the time, was bringing the European architects, particularly Aldo Rossi, who came as a visitor at the same time I was there. It was the period of the Modena Cemetery. Here's Rossi at the Institute, John Haydeck, Rafael Moneo, Mario Gandolsonis, Tony Fidler. So it was really a tremendously exciting period to study architecture, and a kind of privileged place to be in New York with all of these currents coming together. The American academic current meeting the European So from the Institute, I went to study at Cooper Union with John Haydick, an immensely charismatic teacher. And one of the things that was very strong at Cooper Union was the culture of drawing, the idea that that drawing practice is fundamental to design. And the craft of drawing, if you will, was very deeply embedded in the teaching at Cooper Union. This is an analysis drawing that was part of the curriculum. It's the Palazzo Farnese Caprarola pentagon plan that becomes an important thing. And the conceit of this particular drawing is that with the pentagon, there's a strange flattening of the perspective. That if it were a square building, you would never see the front and the side simultaneously. So the front is drawn in elevation and the sides in perspective here. Again, just as a matter of sort of, at this point, almost historical record, this was my thesis at Cooper Union, which involved actually late 18th century industrial building, which had fallen into ruin, which had this kind of remarkable plan spanning the river there. And under the influence of Bernard Schumi, who was teaching there at that time, and John Haydick, this was the period in John Haydick's work of the masks, so this interest in theatricality, performance. This sort of abandoned industrial site was turned into a site for experimental theater, with theaters here and here, and then a kind of large open area. This you may recognize is Oscar Schlemmer's notation for the gesture dance, sort of collaged in there, again with this influence of Schumi and notations and diagrams and so on. So that's a drawing of all the components from the thesis. I had a very disorganized architectural education. I was out of school for 4 or 5 years. I spent a couple of years working for Richard Meyer. This is a drawing which I did of the High Museum of Art. And then came to Spain and worked for about a year and a half for Rafael Moneo. This is one of the drawings that I did at that time. The museum in Mérida was pretty far along at that time, but I think this was done for an exhibition. So again, these were formative experiences for me, particularly the fairly brief time that I spent in Spain. I came back to the U.S. It's 1986, and I went to graduate school for a master's degree at Princeton. Now, this was a rather strange time at Princeton, because you had the collision of two very, very different sensibilities being played out. This is Michael Graves' proposal for the Whitney Museum, which was ultimately around 1984, it was turned down. So the postmodern influence was losing force as a kind of viable alternative within the profession. Or certainly within the academic circles, although curiously enough, this was also the time when firms like Kohn Pedersen Fox were turning postmodernism into a kind of corporate style. By 1987, the exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art on Deconstructivist Architecture, and these young faculty who had come into Princeton, Michael Hayes, Mark Wigley, Beatrice Colomina, that were pushing in a completely different direction. So the experience I had at Princeton as a graduate student was really trying to navigate between these two very, very different directions. Michael Graves was still, in a sense, the dominant voice within the design curriculum, and then you had these young people pushing different ideas in terms of the history and theory. So the emergence of the journal Assemblage, the first issue of Assemblage came out during my time as a graduate student at Princeton when Michael Hayes was teaching at Princeton for 2 years, and then I later became the projects editor for Assemblage. So again, not so much to show you the project, but to give you a feel for the kinds of themes I think the other thing that as students at the time, well, in my case particularly, having been exposed to the theories of Aldo Rossi and thinking about the traditional European city, was to look at American cities and realize that the terms that had been proposed to think about the European city, typology, morphology, really didn't apply so much to this dispersed urbanism of the American cities and the kind of huge expansive space of the West. So I did a master's thesis on Phoenix, Arizona, and in particular, a proposal to do a large football stadium and a kind of urbanistic insertion within this sort of loose, scattered urban fabric of Phoenix. So this was the project model. You can see tried to create a kind of large-scale urban space here, with the stadium as a kind of set piece within that. Michael Graves was my studio, was my thesis advisor. He hated the project. I inserted a hotel into the stadium. He said, that's a terrible idea. Nobody would ever do that. So again, I think already this interest in mixing programs and large-scale urbanism is present. This was around 87 that I did this project. So that's the kind of background when I entered the profession and started simultaneously teaching and working. I really went directly from, you know, having had this sort of longer interval and work between undergraduate and graduate school, I was able to enter directly into teaching, first, as I said, at Harvard with the final year of Moneo's chairmanship, and then at Columbia University. As a kind of immediate background to that, a study that I had started actually at Princeton that was then published in Assemblage in, I think it was also 1989, if you go back to this opposition in a way between the classicism, the postmodern classicism of Michael Graves and the deconstructivist impulse to the game of fragmentation, of disjunction, how to sort of reconcile those two? Well, for me at least, Piranesi and the way that Manfredo Tafuri had written about the Campo Marzio was a way to reconcile the classical impulse with the deconstructivist game of fragments. So it was really a study of the planimetric notations of the Campo Marzio, and you know, some actually very strange moments that one can find in that plan, projected up as a kind of rereading of those plan notations, and also some kind of Piranesi was one of the engravers on the Noli plan, so in fact it's possible to directly superimpose the Campo Marzio proposal of Piranesi with the Noli plan, and you'll find certain points of perfect coincidence, and then certain points where you see that Piranesi has invented these things from scratch. So that. I think in retrospect, I can see at least as some sort of hint about these ideas about field conditions that were to emerge somewhat later. So again, these are drawings that are 35 years old, something like that. Parallel to this, my first very small works as an architect. This is the first thing I built in New York. It's a gallery for contemporary art. And again, I think in retrospect, there's something about the space of the gallery that is not complete until it's occupied by the works of art. So the idea of the gallery as a kind of empty frame that has to be completed by the occupation is something that I think translated to the later thinking about urbanism. The idea that the work of the architect is to sort of create the platform or the framework, which is then completed by people who come later. And again, just to reiterate that long-standing interest in questions of representation and drawing practices. So this is the Swedish translation fields from object to fields. And interestingly enough, certainly there's a very strong relationship between the sort of field conditions ideas and Alison Peter Smithson's ideas about the map building. That was a little bit less explicit, but I think again, in the Alison and Peter Smithson article on map building from, I don't know the exact date, early 1960s, there again is this idea of the architecture, and this is the architecture being a kind of framework that is later completed by the inhabitants of the building or the city. So that notion of process, I think, was already implicit in the idea of field conditions. I think the other thing probably to say about the field conditions is, first of all, that when it was ultimately published in Points and Lines in 99, there were three chapters: contextual tactics, infrastructural urbanism, and field conditions, all of which I think were ways to think about this relationship between architecture and the city, again, to build on this sort of background with thinkers like Rossi, but then to try and say, how are those ideas going to play out in the dispersed landscape of the American city? I think there is something very specifically American about the question of field conditions, the sense of occupying a kind of expansive horizontal field, of cities that are porous to nature, that don't have a fixed boundary between the countryside and the city. So I think there is something probably highly specific to the American city about the field conditions idea. But it was an intuition, I think, also about a way of working that would work from the part towards the whole, by the aggregation of individual pieces to create a larger sense of the whole. An idea that it would be possible to have high degree of specificity locally, that then, but as opposed to the project of deconstructivism, which was always about breaking and fragmentation and disjunction, the idea that you could create a more continuous whole, but with locally differentiated parts. So this is a Melnikov's Sukharov market. So you can see the way this single unit is aggregated into, again, into a kind of mat building condition with streets. It becomes kind of labyrinthine. Of course, the example of Logarissier's Venice Hospital, which he himself says was influenced by these ideas of the mat building. Examples from the natural world of herding and flocking. These are caribou responding to a helicopter above. So again, independent agents working together to create some notion of a kind of loose whole. Oh, what have I done? Curious. Okay. Well, here we are. So again, just two pieces of context. Again, in the kind of interest of giving the background here. As I said, the younger generation around Columbia, Greg Lynn, Jesse Reiser, and myself, we were certainly reacting to the previous generation and the project of deconstructivism. So the project of fragmentation, of disjunction, that had been so important for architects like Libeskind and Eisenman was something we were consciously pushing back on. The project of fragmentation seemed to us to be a kind of a dead end, that you, with fragmentation, you could only escalate, that the shock of breakage, of disjunction, was going to lose force over time and simply become a kind of empty metaphor. So we were more interested in smoothness and connectivity as opposed to fragmentation and disjunction. That seemed to be a more positive model. Second thing, of course, was the emergence of the computer. So this, again, 1994 at Columbia University are the first paperless studios with computers in the design studio, and people like Greg Lynn working with Maya and using the capacities of the computer to model continuous surfaces and so on. So in some ways, I would say my project of field operations was a different response to the potentials of computation. Again, computation works by iteration, the continual reiteration of many, many different steps. Greg used the computer to create biomorphic forms that were tending towards the object. I was interested in this sort of abstract iterative capacity of the computer to produce a kind of open-ended field condition. So also I was looking, Greg was looking at biological sources, I was looking more at the art world. This is an artist named Barry LeVay who did these sort of experiments. This is a diagram that a colleague gave me actually much later, but this is the Linnaean model where species are divided sort of arbitrarily. Here you have a sort of archipelago model where you have independent islands but no interaction. And this kind of model, again, local specificity and overall coherence was the kind of objective of the field conditions were. Again, just for sort of historical interest, competition project from around that period of time, trying to put these ideas of a local relationship among small scale aggregated parts and a kind of loose envelope together. So that you could say, now interestingly enough, when I was thinking about field conditions, I was not thinking about landscape at all. And that may seem like a kind of blind spot in a way, because it's so obvious that field conditions has to do with landscape. Towards the end of the 1990s, that opening up to thinking about landscape and ecology began to inform the sort of field conditions thinking. The precise moment, I think, was I was asked to moderate a panel on Dutch architecture, and I think Winnie Maas was there, and in trying to understand some of the Dutch architecture of the late 1990s, the importance of landscape as a kind of motivating force in the Dutch work that was taking place at that time sort of opened up my thinking to landscape, which then led to this collaboration with James Korner. So from 1999 to about 2003, I worked in collaboration with a landscape architect, James Korner. James Korner had been, along with Charles Waldheim, the person to coin this term landscape urbanism for this intersection of questions of the large-scale urbanism, particularly in the American context, that deals not so much with the built fabric of the city, but with the void of the city, with the empty space of the city. There was a very famous statement by Kohlhaas sometime in the middle 1990s, where he said that architects can no longer control the solid of the city, you have to shape the city by means of the void. So I think that, landscape urbanism, and Korner in particular, Kohlhaas also talks about seeding a site with potential. So again, there's almost a kind of ecological analogy there, that you're planting the seeds of the future development of the site. Thinking about urbanism as a process as opposed to a kind of fixed endpoint. So I think in thinking about the emergence of landscape urbanism in the late 1990s, it's important to go back to this project from 1983 for a couple of reasons. First of all, because some of the protagonists are the same, Shumi on the left and Kohlhaas on the right. The Laviolette competition in 1983 is significant, I think, for a number of reasons, not the least of which is the first and second prizes were given to architects, not to landscape architects. And certainly the use of diagrams, the idea of change and succession over time. Both the Shumi and the Kohlhaas projects worked on the basis of an idea of inscribing a kind of loose ordering system over the site. In Shumi's case, the point grid, and in Kohlhaas's, in Kohlhaas's case, the organization in bands that would then later be completed and would be able to accommodate different agents, different architects working on the site over a long period of time. So Shumi famously had a system of points, lines, and planes. And I think what's significant about the Shumi project, I think it was, to be honest, it was best as a diagram at this stage. The specific architectural realization is problematic in my mind, but I think it's a brilliant diagram. And it's a brilliant diagram not only for its formal properties, but because each one of these different formal systems implies a programmatic occupation. So the points, for example, accommodate very easily the kind of programs that you need in a big public park. Things like cafes and kiosks and bike rentals and so on, all of which will be easily accommodated in a small, little punctual intervention. The lines, of course, are about movement and distribution of people, and the planes, again, accommodate a very particular kind of landscape program. So large-scale concerts, fields for playing sports, and so on. So the point line plane organization in Shumi's project has also a very robust but specific translation to program. So I think that was something that was very, very strong there. Now the Kohlhaas project, the OMA project, again, this organization of bands, a very strong geometrical structure, but then it permitted a high degree of freedom between the different bands. So in both cases, and perhaps actually in a more sophisticated way in the Kohlhaas project, you had a way of reconciling specificity with freedom that made this a kind of robust urbanistic diagram. So this, I think, was a kind of thinking that was in the back of the minds of people in the early days of landscape urbanism. But I think there's a key difference, which is that in both the case of the Shumi and the Kohlhaas project, you could say that the critical message of the project is that all nature is culture. All nature is seen through the lens of the intervention of human beings on the landscape. That there's no such thing as nature in its kind of natural state. That all nature is mediated by culture. So you have nature forced into the geometries of urbanism and architecture. Now, in the late 1990s, and in collaboration at this point with landscape architects and ecologists, I think that equation gets reversed. It becomes less about seeing nature through the lens of culture, but more about seeing culture through the lens of nature. In other words, how can we learn the kind of lessons of ecology, of emergence, of adaptability, of the systems of feedback that characterize ecological systems? How can we take those ideas and apply them to a large urban park? So for me, one of the best ways to understand the emergence of landscape architecture in the late 1990s is to pair the 1983 La Villette competition with this 2000-2001 competition for Downtown Street Park in Toronto, where Kohlhaas and Schumi are also appear, and it's the first project that James Corner and I did together. We were the kind of young kids that were selected among the six finalist teams. And it really became an important project for working out these early ideas of landscape urbanism. Downsview Park was an abandoned Canadian Air Force space. There were a system of streets and so on, and there were barracks here. It had all been removed, and leaving this kind of available, kind of open field. So our first thinking about the project was to put it in terms of the large scale, both urban and natural systems of Toronto. So one of the things that was interesting about the site is it fell exactly on the watershed between the two major river systems in Toronto, the Humber and the Don. So really, again, if you think ecologically, the limits of the site are not fixed. So that species, weather, everything will migrate in and out of the site, and there's this obligation to think about a specific urban site in its larger urban and ecological context. Now, we were practicing as field operations, so of course the first thing we did was to collage sort of field-like organizations over the site, but we realized that lacked specificity. So we came up with this organizing diagram. If a conventional 19th century park by Olmsted or somebody has this kind of loose relationship between pathways and green and the various programmatic elements, we would consolidate circulation and active programs in one continuous band that's a circuit, a kind of closed figure. And then counterposed to that were these ecological systems that would flow through and around the site and not necessarily respect the specific boundaries of the site. So the project was really the superposition then of those two systems. So again, I think this was typical of the thinking around landscape urbanism to really think, and this is, I think, in some ways where the influence of Schumi's three-part diagram is, that you set up a kind of large-scale diagrammatic schema that then gets played out locally, but then also will allow for the intervention and development of the project by different agencies and entities. In other words, that the work of the landscape urbanist is to establish a kind of working framework that then gets completed by others. So it's this idea that the city or a large urban park is not the work necessarily of a single architect or a single author. So one I think particularly important proposition here, and again, just to give you maybe a little bit of specificity, of course one of the problems that landscape architects have to deal with is the retainage of water on the site. The normal landscape architect's solution to that is to create holding ponds. Those can be very nice, but we thought it would be much more interesting to make that into something that was more porous to the landscape. So this idea of a kind of corrugated landscape with wet areas and dry areas, and then what would happen is the same configuration, different parts of the site, over time would develop in very, very different ways. So in the uplands part, we would have a kind of tall grass prairie, whereas in the lower parts where there was more water, you would have a denser, different kind of spatiality. So again, this idea that there's a kind of initial move on the site, which is to give it a certain degree of specificity, and then change to really exploit the notion that landscapes are always developing and changing over time, and create different spatial regimes. So, you know, there's a useful thing that architects work to the construction budget, landscape architects work to the maintenance budget, because landscapes are always developing and changing over time. Central Park, for example, it costs about $100,000 per year per acre to maintain Central Park in a continuous state. I think many of the kind of innovative landscape architects in the late 1990s, Jim Corner among them, said, okay, instead of trying to maintain the park in a single fixed state, in other words, the landscape grows to a kind of climax state and then you maintain it in that fixed state, let's use that capacity of the landscape to change over time to produce a kind of controlled and steered difference over time. So these various precepts became, in a sense, sort of formalized in the practices of landscape urbanism. Again, around this time, 1999, 2000, and there now exists a pretty extensive literature, including a new book by Charles Waldheim that talks about this. So it's in a way been consolidated as a kind of academic and practical field. There are projects of landscape urbanism. This is an image which for me is important. Again, I mentioned the way in which I think landscape urbanism belongs to this expansive space of the American city, the idea of a city like Los Angeles that is porous to nature and also enabled by the infrastructure of the highways. So again, the kind of coincidence between ecological thinking and infrastructural thinking, that in a way, these two images, a rural landscape and an urban landscape, to a landscape urbanist, they're actually functioning in a kind of similar way. That there's a kind of geometric trace that's laid down, and then the life is emerging around that structure over time. I think the other, again, kind of, you know, interesting to me at least, sort of historical fact, that landscape architecture as a discipline was very well situated to become a kind of synthetic discipline between, say, infrastructure, civil engineering, horticulture, ecology, urbanism, and architecture. So landscape architecture, because it had a weaker disciplinary definition, was able to capture these other disciplines and work in a kind of interdisciplinary way. I mean, in some ways, the younger landscape architects were sort of reacting to this situation. So if in the 19th century, Olmsted's Central Park is fundamental to the urban structure of New York City, by the 1980s, 1990s, This is Martha Schwartz. You don't need to know that. I mean, we're just making her a kind of strong woman here. Landscape architecture had become a decorative adjunct to bad corporate architecture. So the landscape architects who were behind the landscape urbanism thinking, they wanted to discover, again, a kind of structural ordering capacity to landscape that had been lost over time, but of course they also knew that the Olmsted Park depends on the continuity of the fabric around it, and instead of working with configurations like this, they were working with configurations like this. So the field, in a way, had to be opened up and expanded. So with that background, let me maybe just work quickly through what I think are the working precepts of landscape urbanism. And we can move on to some other work. Obviously, this relationship between the artificial and the natural. And again, thinking as much, not only the critical recognition that that nature is a human artifice, but the idea that there actually are lessons directly to be learned from ecological thinking for architecture. So, even a kind of untouched Western landscape like this is mediated through the technology of the camera. And of course, there are these examples of nature being forced into a kind of artificial condition. And again, even Central Park, which we tend to think of as a natural landscape, is an entirely engineered landscape. This is a construction view of Central Park. Now, the other interesting point, I mentioned that in the 1990s, in architecture, there was this fascination with surfaces that was enabled by the new modeling capacities of computers. So again, there was an interest of turning towards landscape, that landscape architects, in a way, were experts in surfaces and pattern. So the kind of artificial landscapes that we would associate with the architecture of the 1990s were certainly borrowing from questions of landscape. The difference, I would say, is that for a landscape architect, surfaces have material properties. And those material properties are determinant about what will happen on the site. Jim Corner used to talk about this as thinking like a farmer. So a farmer knows intuitively that the areas that are lower, that have different kinds of sunlight, are going to behave differently from the areas that are higher and have different drainage, different soil chemistry, and so on. So I think it's important to distinguish, in a way, between the architectural use of folded surfaces and the way that a landscape architect would think about the condition of the surface as something with material properties. And I think the other, again, thinking about the precedent of Shumi and Kohlhaas in the 1980s, that landscape architecture offers a different model to architecture for the combination of program and event. That rather than specific spaces with limits that are defined for specific programs, here's the auditorium, here's the cafeteria, here's the kindergarten, there's this idea of surfaces that can be appropriated for many, many different activities that have a kind of architectural specificity but an indeterminate programmatic capacity. And I think that's also where the diagram comes in, that again, if you're organizing a very large scale site or large number of programs, you have to think diagrammatically in a way. You have to think about the difference, let's say, between a distributed network and the different kinds of connections between the points and the nodes. The nodes and the pathways. That information travels differently in a system like this than it does in a system like this or a system like this. So I think that's part of the kind of large scale, very abstract programmatic thinking that characterized some of the work in landscape urbanism. These are diagrams produced by a landscape ecologist, Richard Foreman at Harvard University, who in a very scientific way is analyzing the relationships between the organization, spatial organization of landscapes and the kind of life and species that they support. So this, again, this is an example of the way in which, instead of going from culture to nature, we're going from nature to culture. Now, the other thing I think is that sort of emerged. Again, it was a product of the thinking at the time. You know, remember, we're talking about early 1990s, the emergence of the World Wide Web, and these models of the kind of the connectivity that's happening now at a kind of a virtual level. That in a way we can see the information exchange that happens in a landscape as similar to the kind of connectivity information exchange that's happening in the world of media. So going back, for example, to the famous Louis Kahn diagram that sees the city of Philadelphia as a system of flows that are channeled by the streets. I mentioned that with Jim Corder and myself, whenever we were doing projects, we always wanted to see the specific site, in this case, the landfill at Freshgills, in terms of the larger web of connections that would influence the site from outside, you know, including, for example, the flyover for species that are migrating from the southern hemispheres, who would stop over on the site. Oh, I keep doing that, don't I? Well, here we are. Process and change. So the perhaps the most important lesson from ecology and landscape for urbanism is this notion that sites don't have a fixed condition, that cities and landscapes are always changing, always evolving, and the landscape is in fact the product of change over time. The landscape that's produced by erosion. And of course landscapes change with the seasons. This is Asplund